Welcome to the Melbourne Press Club. It's a great pleasure to be standing here today. We do a lot of events at the Melbourne Press Club, but this is a particularly special one, I think, for us and for many of us. It's 30 years since three newspapers in one day. Who would have thought? Who would ever try that again? It's terrific to see around the room so many familiar faces from the classes of 89. Isn't it a marvellous 30 years? No one looks a day older. Fantastic. I'd like to particularly welcome, and there's many, many people I'd like to welcome by name, but we can't spend all day with that. But in particular, I'd like to single out to welcome four people who will lead our discussion after the main course is served shortly. Bruce Guthrie, Steve Foley, Krista Kretser, and Louise Graham, who will run us through some of the highs and lows of that extraordinary couple of years. I'd also like to pay a particular welcome to our and acknowledge our sponsors at the Melbourne Press Club, without whom we cannot do what we do. Our principal sponsors, Virgin Australia and Monash University. Our premium sponsors, Midder Ellison, represented today by Peter Bartlett. Commonwealth Bank, Matthew Keenan, and Crown Resorts, Chris Riley. I'd also like to acknowledge our major sponsors and our major media sponsors, who you will see shortly on the board during the course of the lunch. There's a couple of reasons why it's me standing up here today. Firstly, I guess Michael Rowland and Adele Ferguson are a little bit particular about who they hang out with. Secondly, I have a sort of a fleeting association with this historic period. I was, for a period of about 4, maybe 5 months, on the staff of the Sunday Herald. That ended rather unhappily when the editor of the period, peace be with him, and I decided we could no longer get on with each other, and I walked out and was unemployed for several months thereafter. However, so I have a fleeting association. Now, it's not on my CV because I think the umpires would say insufficient distance, play on, in relation to that. My brief career on the Melbourne Herald was distinguished by one particular thing, and they'll see a little bit about that and hear a little bit about that as we go through. But, of course, I was nearly killed on assignment for the Sunday Herald, reporting the Civil War in Bougainville. The wisdom of my actions can indeed be brought into question, but on that occasion I was on assignment with Rob Leeson, and pleased to see that Rob is here with us today. Now, I've kind of waited 30 years or so to have this out in public, but this is my opportunity. As all of the snappers in the room would know, there are three rules for being a press photographer. Number one, you drive the car and don't prang it more than once every 6 months. Number two, take photos that are more or less in focus. And number three, when required, take a bullet for the journo. Now, Rob and I were on assignment in Bougainville. We were in a helicopter which landed in a plantation on the north of the island. As we landed and were about to get out of the helicopter, representatives of the Bougainville Liberation Revolutionary Army came out of the jungle and started firing at us. Now, I got slightly wounded in the shoulder by a bullet that came through the front of the helicopter and exploded in the wall behind me. At that very moment that bullet came through the front of the helicopter, Rob Leeson should have been sitting up straight. However, he was leaning over, fossicking in his camera bag, and therefore the bullet went through the webbing at the top of his seatbelt and came through and copped me. So, utter dereliction of duty. Shame on you, Leeson. But good to see you here, Fruit Fly. Welcome. Just a couple of other things in terms of logistics today. Your ticket includes a complimentary drink with your meal. I know a few people seem to have finished theirs already, but should you require more drinks, you're most welcome to order. There's a drinks list on the table, and staff will oblige with drinks by the glass or a bottle if you so desire. So feel free. Just mention a couple of upcoming things for the club. On the 4th of September, we'll have a lunch with Alan Fells, and on the 10th of September, Annabel Crabb, talking about her quarterly essay. So everyone welcome as usual, and you'll find details in the flyers on your tables and on the Press Club website. So we'll now break for the main course, and then I'll come back shortly to get things underway properly. So welcome again.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Sunday Sun and the Sunday Herald.
Excuse me, Mrs. Calvert-Jones. We're doing an in-house video for the Herald and Weekly Times, and we'd like to run a few questions by you before you get past the question. Just 30 seconds.
Yeah, it's got to be 30 seconds because the people are back.
Okay.
Righto, fine.
What are your first impressions of the product?
Well, I think both products are absolutely tremendous. I've only seen them this second, but obviously I've been watching them over the few weeks or months as they've been developing, and I'm absolutely thrilled. I think it's really exciting.
The last big meteor, I guess, that just cascaded out onto the landscape. I mean, three newspapers anywhere in the world on the same day didn't happen before and hasn't happened since. Well, it's a fairly remarkable thing because Melbourne was already probably one of the greatest newspaper markets in the world then, with The Sun and The Age and The Herald probably selling a million papers a day, so there was no one screaming out for another newspaper.
It was a great event. The Herald Weekly Times had this big party. They took over the tennis centre. They did it up just something magnificent.
What else is there to do on a Sunday in Melbourne except read newspapers?
Have you laid any bets as to who's going to win the war?
No, I would think The Sun and The Age would do quite well. I think the Sunday Herald is a question mark because people don't expect it to come out in the morning. But once they find that it is out in the morning, then I think all three, there's room for all three, aren't there?
I think it's going to do damage to television. I mean, especially morning television.
What do you expect from a Sunday newspaper?
I think a credible horoscope is the main thing.
The funny thing was, the print run between the Herald and the Sun was a million papers coming out in one place in the basement presses at the Herald Weekly Times. I don't think they'd ever done anything like that circulation before.
So Rupert Murdoch, having just taken over HWT, maybe with concerns about the size of The Age and its revenues and a bit of envy and jealousy, and perhaps seeing that the Sydney market with the Sunday Telegraph and the Fairfax Sun Herald, we were raking, you know, multi-million dollar revenues compared to the then Melbourne market, which had the Sunday Observer and the Sunday Press, which was a combined HWT-Syme arrangement, if you like, of convenience to try and stop Rupert coming in originally. So when he took over, he was clearly going to make a splash. So in early 89, he signalled that he had had enough of this cosy arrangement with the dirted enemy, Fairfax or Syme, and said we're going to have a Sunday paper. And then it became papers.
A few weeks out from launch date, which was August 20, 1989, we got the inevitable call from Rupert. He, of course, wanted to be updated on our progress. So Alan Farrelly, the editor of the Sunday Herald, immediately got on a plane to London and took the final dummies, which we'd been slaving over for 2 months. And we thought it fulfilled the brief. We felt, you know, we'd produced a classy-looking, you know, broadsheet Sunday newspaper. It was mostly pitched at an AB audience. We felt that's what it did. And Alan rang me all around midnight here in Melbourne from London to tell me what had happened. And he began the conversation with, there's good news and there's bad news. I thought, well, tell me the good news. He said, Murdoch loves the look of the paper. He thinks it's the most beautiful paper he's ever seen. Great, what's the bad news? He said, it's not the paper he wants. So, crestfallen, Alan explains how Murdoch literally dumped 2 months' work in the bin and told us we had to start all over again. He evidently wanted it to look more like the Afternoon Herald, our sister paper. You know, it was rather devastating, but that's what the man wanted and that's what he was going to get.
it seemed to be going all right, but Rupert never lets on much. He pretty well criticises more than he praises. So he went through the dummies and looked through them, and his big criticism at the end of it was that there wasn't enough good writing in the paper, and you need some good writers. At that stage, everybody was in this big fight for people and talent, and there was money getting thrown around everywhere, and being the poor relation, we had to sort of use our best resources to get on. And we managed to get a hold of Philip Knightley, who, of course, had worked for Rupert and, you know, Thalidomide and all that was on the London Times. He was very surprised. He said, "How did you get Philip Knightley?" And I said, "Well, you know, I just know him and we managed to get him." And he was very he was surprised, but I think a bit upset about it too, because as I felt anyway, he wanted all the best talent had to go on the Herald, not on the Sun.
We got a really good staff together. I think that was probably the key, because you had to get people who were prepared to take the risk of either leaving HWT or News to come across to the dreaded enemy. So that was like a treasonous act in itself, to join a Sunday paper with no certain future. Anyway, we managed to persuade people who just enjoyed the, warm to the challenge and weren't going to die wondering. Jeff Slattery and Mickey Gordon and Caroline Wilson and, you know, Guthrie and Jan Applegren and Mike Sheehan. You know, we got some really good people, and that was the core, because they were all in this together. It was us against them type attitude, both internally at the Age to some degree and certainly against the two papers. And that mentality meant we would do whatever it took, right, to get the story, get the paper out on time, which was a challenge, and try and survive. That morning, we were dreading that the competition would have some super world exclusive lined up and we were going to be severely embarrassed. And as it turned out, they didn't, but we had nothing. Any stories we had been exhausted or knocked off. So, but we did have Mickey Gordon manage to jag an interview with Keating, which was his first interview post the Kirribilli agreement, the famous Kirribilli agreement, which was a very, very revealing interview in itself. So we knew we had something for page one with a bigger piece inside. But then we lucked on to the prospect that the two of them might actually agree to be in a photograph together, which was a bit of an eyebrow raiser. So Mickey arranged the photograph, and we sent Wayne Ludby up to Canberra that morning to take it before they changed their minds. And Roz Hawke happened to be in the room when this was being taken, and she said, "Oh, come on, Dad, put your arms around Paul." So he did, and that made the picture.
What more perfect way to open your Sunday than by opening the new Sunday Herald? You can leaf through environmental issues, tune into new business technologies.
The Herald was the one that impressed the most because it was different. It was completely different.
As you can see, the mask is quite different from the Daily. Double column blurb, which wasn't necessarily all the time, but big footy, good political story, good art story, which is ours, so these are ours.
How much thought is going to go into what photograph you use? Will it always be a sports photo? I mean, how can...
No. But right now, I mean, I'm assured by everybody that football is big in this town. And it's even bigger now that the Magpies have crushed Fitzroy and now in the final five. Grand finals are coming up. I figure that we'll keep sport on there till the grand finals. I mean, these guys do this, you know? I'm just standing around waiting to go to lunch. Yeah, Rupert likes that one.
The Age had the great picture of Keating and Hawke together in the thing. So that was a bit of a go. So we picked the best thing that we knew, and that was Collingwood. And they had a big win that day and short of a place in the finals. So we went with Collingwood and I think Peter Dacos on the front page.
Well, we had our own staff, of course, but we also were heavily dependent on the sister paper, the Afternoon Herald, for a lot of backup, particularly with subbing and, you know, photography and things like that. And one of the key relationships as it developed from the beginning was between Mark Knight, who was a cartoonist of the Herald, and Alan Farrelly. They really struck up a great, you know, working relationship. And when I think about it, you know, Mark really, I think, developed a whole new sort of style of cartooning, in my view, through Alan's use of him. And the best illustration of that, there were several, but the best illustration was the fall of the Berlin Wall. And we were a day after the breaking news of the Berlin Wall coming down, and Alan always was looking for the, you know, a different way of interpreting the story, the big running story, and he got Mark to do this fantastic full-width panoramic cartoon of a figure crashing through the Berlin Wall and graffitied, you know, Mikhail Gorbachev was here. But he stuck on it this incredible headline, Ich bin ein Berliner, the famous line from John F. Kennedy, and the whole thing just gelled.
The Sunday Sun was always expected to be a success. It was supposed to be the same as the daily paper. It was going to be the biggest circulation paper. And so when we didn't match the daily paper, all of a sudden there were all sorts of brickbats flying around. Whereas the Herald and the Age, nobody really expected whatever came was good enough, I think. And the Herald got very good reviews at the start, just not so much for the circulation, but the fact that it looked such a good paper and, you know, it was a Rupert Murdoch's baby, I suppose.
Well, the Sunday Herald, you couldn't be but a little bit envious because both papers, the Sun and the Herald, were bigger than ours in terms of overall pagination. The Sunday Herald had a really good quality, glossy 72-page magazine, sort of London quality, which, you know, overshadowed the Good Weekend, which was then running in the Sydney Morning Herald and the Age on Saturday. They had, you know, a really good crew, lots of experience, people who'd edited papers in Hong Kong and The Australian and other things. So a lot more experience, a lot more resources, and a lot more money. And the Sunday Sun was kind of a seventh-day edition, if you like, perhaps a bit lighter than the Daily in some senses, probably trying to pick up some of the old Sunday press market. But, and it was its own solid, you know, seventh-day edition. So they were strong in their own right. So there was no great surprises because we knew what was coming. And we were kind of the player up the middle in this so-called pincer movement, the middle ground, as they called it. And everyone said, well, if you caught neither one nor the other, you're going to lose out, was the common ethos. But we proved them wrong.
It was more of a defensive move by Rupert. In those days, Saturday Age was, you know, the river's gold, and he thought that that would sneak into the Sunday Age in classifieds. And that was the reason for, I think, bringing out a Herald. And in the end, when that didn't happen, there was no advertising in any other papers, really. It didn't happen. I think, it didn't matter if it went out of business.
It was a once-in-a-lifetime thing, and anyone who went through it is awfully glad they were there and be part of it.
One of the things I think that we've lost since 1989, apart from a couple of newspapers, innumerable journalists' jobs, is the wonderful era in which there was great mobility for journalists around this town. I'm one of those examples of someone who's worked on both sides of the river, and here today we have a number of people who've done the same thing. So Bruce Guthrie, of course, has edited both the Herald Sun and the Age. Steve Foley was first deputy editor of the Sunday Herald and later editor of the Sunday Age, as well as another range of senior jobs at the Age. And of course, Louise Graham was a picture editor at the Sunday Age and later picture editor of the Sunday Herald magazine. So great mobility there. I guess Chris is the odd man out here that he stayed put on the south of the river, for better or worse. So thank you all for being here. I thought we might begin by asking each of the people on stage to reflect for a minute or two about highlights, reflections of that moment. Maybe Bruce, if you could kick it off.
And this is not booze, it's tea for my sore throat, sorry. Look, we wouldn't be here today without Rupert. I know we say that a lot, but he was the disruptor that led to this and everything that has flowed from it, even this lunch, I guess. What hasn't been revealed before, I think, was that Rupert first tipped his hand not in 1989, but in June 1988. We were at a confab in Aspen, Colorado, of all his editors, and Eric Beecher, who'd been editing the Herald for about 12 months and was desperately trying to get the circulation needle moving, went to Rupert, his home on the mountain, which I remember included a lap pool in the lounge room, and tried to convince Rupert to take the paper to a morning paper. So the Melbourne Herald, which had been an afternoon paper for, you know, a century, here was Eric trying to convince him to make it a morning paper. And he came down from the mountain, and a bit like Steve was recalling earlier, Eric said, I've got good news and bad news. And I said, well, what's the bad news? He said, we're an afternoon paper until he gives up on it. What's the good news? The good news is he wants to do a Sunday paper. In fact, he wants to do two Sunday papers. So that was in June 1988. And of course, a little over 12 months later, it all unfolded.
Chris, would you like to?
Yeah, hi. You were saying about the all the people that we who were ready to be poached and worked on these papers. The other day I was looking through some of the lists of staff and I came across one, Anthony Catalano. He was a $150 a week police roundsman for us.
Rip off.
Everybody's talked about Rupert's role in instigating this war, so to speak. And I just thought one of the ways I could illustrate how involved he was is to read a fax that he sent to me after one of the editions of the paper. We didn't have the internet in those days. But this one said, "Dear Chris, just a few impressions of last week's paper. I do not like all the colour on page one. We didn't have colour, it was spot colour. The splash on the top is questionable, but okay. The rest of it, mainly borders, cheapens the whole paper. The page seven story about Bill Hayden has several things wrong with it. Firstly, it is mean about somebody whom the public now wants to respect. The story was about Bill Hayden's love child. And secondly, it is superfluous. The promotional plug on page two would have been bigger. That was a plug to the Bill Hayden story. Now that we are printing the paper on one run, we should be able to make it flow better from news to features and back again. I thought the picture special was just another lot of boring space. I suggested pages of the week's real news pictures. I don't know what you call the headline type that you're using on some of your features. For example, pages 36, 37, 38, 39, etc. But there is something very old-fashioned about it. I don't think it has ever been used before in Melbourne. I thought the sports pages looked very good, especially the racing. Why do we have to illustrate stories with pictures of unattractive-looking journalists?
Is there any other kind?
These are just some quick criticisms. There are many other things about the paper which are excellent. With best wishes, sincerely, Rupert.
You've admitted the last line, Chris. I hope you succeed at whatever you try next.
Well, if that wasn't enough, I'll show you. Here's a couple more. These are a couple more foolscap pages of points that Rupert found wrong with the paper. The other thing that people aren't aware of is that it was very difficult to get the papers out because up until then, the news agents didn't come out on a Sunday. And one of the things that we achieved, I suppose, by bringing out three newspapers was to get them to actually open up. But didn't take long before they also closed up. And just to end this discussion, I'll read you a letter that was sent to us by a newsagent when he closed up. Sunday, bloody Sunday. We tackled the job with a great deal of zest. No matter what happened, we tried our best. Sad to say, we had no pay for 6 hours' work on bloody Sunday. It was not our decision to open the shop. Strangely enough, it came from the top. I think it's time to let my wife get some enjoyment out of her life. Just to have a decent, good sleep, and not wake to the beep, beep, beep. Sunday trading here has been a big flop. It has been decided to give it the chop. You can still get your papers from the local milk bar, which is better for you not having to go so far. Sunday deliveries will continue without fuss. To make arrangement, just contact us. Over to you, Steve.
Thanks, Chris. Steve, yeah.
Thank you, Mark. It's good to be here and good to see so many old friends and faces. Sometimes, I'm completely retired these days, and I have very little to do with my past life, but sometimes I get asked, what was it like? And the best answer I can give them is that it's as if you were transported to the perfect or the ideal newspaper world, like a journalistic nirvana without the drugs. I can't think of any other way to describe it, and many in the presentation before have alluded to this. It was a complete one-off. Never in the world had there been three papers launched simultaneously, let alone in one city. And, you know, Melbourne, we thought, was ready for that. In part, I think it was a reflection of the times we're then living in, which was the audacious 80s. Some of you will remember those times, madcap 80s, when anything could be done. We were seeing an orgy of spending and borrowing as if there was no limit. And of course, we'll never know that again. I recall getting drafted in from The Australian, where Alan Farrelly was also working. I was the Victorian editor, he was the managing editor, and we were told we could have virtually a clean slate to build within 3 months a world-class Sunday broadsheet with one stipulation. And of course, we were in no doubt as to who was making this demand, but it had to be the best. So we're told you can have up to 80 staff, which was extraordinary. We had none to begin with. We could have 60 broadsheet pages. They wanted to chuck in a 72-page, as Steve Harris mentioned previously, a 72-page colour magazine, very much inspired and modelled by the, you know, excellent Sunday Times magazine. And oh, by the way, can you do a TV guide? So we had to chuck in a 20-page TV guide at the last minute. I mean, when you contemplate that, it just, in today's climate, I suppose it's hard to imagine, but we did it. And we did it with help, and I should mention at this point that as we gradually did build up our staff, many of whom are here, it's great to see you, we faced this terrible problem of trying to match Rupert's ambitions, particularly in regards to the colour magazine, when we had no editor, we had no staff, we had no ability at that stage to design the damn thing. But the problem was solved, as only a proprietor like Rupert Murdoch can. So if he wants the Sunday Times magazine and the Sunday Herald, what does he do? He sends out the Sunday Times to Melbourne, and that's what happened. He put on a plane a guy named Mike Rand, who was the doyen of art directors, and his protege, John Tennant. And they spent 4 weeks in a miserable, cold little bunker in an old sewing room in Flinders Lane. If you watch The Sopranos, you'll get the idea. And they crafted this beautiful magazine, which fulfilled all his ambitions. Of course, it was only going to be a 48-page magazine, but Rupert was so excited when he saw it, he decided he'd up that from 48 to 72 pages. And while you're at it, bring the paper from 48 to 60 pages, 60 broadsheet pages. Well, it damn well nearly killed us, and in a kind of perverse way, I think it killed the paper.
Good, Louise.
When I start to think about my time at the Sunday Age, one of the things that occurred to me is I actually don't remember much, because I had a 3.5-month-old baby and was breastfeeding on the couch when I was called by Steve Harris to join the Sunday Age, who had in fact been battling putting the paper together, hadn't actually launched yet, and they had 2 weeks to launch and they wanted me to come and consult for a couple of days. So I said, yeah, that'd be fine, I can do a couple of days. Bruce and Steve were very accommodating, and you know, it's not permanent, just come and consult, yep, not a problem. But little did I know, it was the big newspaper war, and it was the most surprising thing to me was that the enemy was bigger within than it was outside. Photographic didn't want to cooperate with us at all. There was cross-rostering, which everyone disagreed with. And the photographers were advised to come back late from jobs so they missed our deadlines. And keys to cupboards with full of lenses mysteriously disappeared, as did sporting passes. They, in fact, did everything they could to stop us from doing anything. And I think in some ways that was what made me stay, because I thought, bugger you blokes, I'm going to do this and we'll do it well. And I had the strong leadership of Bruce Guthrie and Steve Harris backing me all the way. And I sort of was fossicking through some of my stuff, and I'm a bit like Krista Kretser, I'm a bit of a hoarder. And I did find a memo that was in March 1990. So it was 5 months after we'd started. And I didn't realise that this sort of obstruction was going on for so long, but obviously it was. And we had the cricket to cover, and the cricket passes had disappeared again, so I'd organised a pass at the MCC to be collected. The photographer turns up, we'd send a freelancer, we'd hired freelancers because we could see that was the only way we were going to survive. And I sent the freelancer to the MCC, to MCG. India and Pakistan were playing in the first test. And the photographer there was never one of the most cooperative ones anyway, so the pass had in fact disappeared. So we then had to pay to get in the MCC, ask the photographer to send back some films. And in my note that I sent to Steve, the photographer's answer was, tell Louise Graham to go and get stuffed. So that was really what we were up against, and I found that I was kind of more... I knew News Limited. I knew News Limited were obviously going to be at our throats the whole time, but I was really shocked by the way Fairfax itself was trying to eat their young in being the Sunday Age, and offered us no support whatsoever. And, you know, there was... They'd been infiltrated by News Limited, which they didn't like. There was a lot of newcomers, and there was people that had been at the Age before who had been poached and come back. So it was an interesting time for me as a picture editor, because I'd never really struck anything like that before. And I suppose in the end I got my comeuppance, because I ended up going back as picture editor of The Age not a few years later. So those photographers that weren't so nice to me then were very nice to me once I returned. And it was, look, in the end, The Age photographers wanted to work for us. They could see we had the best sports lift out in the town. Our pictures and layout were brave and fresh, and everyone, I felt, at the Sunday Age was very passionate about the image as well as the words. And so from my point, it was actually one of the best places I've worked at, despite the obstruction. We were a close-knit team, and I think since then we've become very good friends and followed each other around in different jobs and crossed the walls many times and gone to and from News Limited and Fairfax, which, you know, at that time was, as Steve said, if you went from one to the other, it was treason and you were made to serve out your time until you could actually go there.
The level of animosity within was incredible. I remember one Saturday morning, Steve and I, we used to take over the Age backbench on a Saturday. We got there and our blurb, which was supposed to be on page 3, was on page 17 that morning of the Saturday Age. And sure enough, we got there. On the blotter was a memo from a very senior Age executive saying, "Dear Mike Smith, just remember, push the Sunday Age blurb back to page 17. The level of animosity was incredible. The enemy was within, clearly.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
I can second that, because I always felt that the biggest opposition we had on the Sunday Sun was the Daily Sun. It was the Monday morning Daily Sun was their biggest circulation paper. It sold over 600,000 copies. Now, we were supposed to match that with the Sunday edition, and that was impossible when they still produced every single sports event in full detail on Monday morning, while we had to do it before an 8 o'clock deadline.
Well, we know, broadly speaking, it ended badly. A couple of papers folded or merged. The Sunday Age, despite all those issues, sort of went on and was to prosper ultimately. But out of all that, and you know, a lot of people clearly, when things fell apart, lost their jobs. But in terms of the journalism that was created, the momentum that was created, was there a lasting impact for journalism in Melbourne and Australia out of that whole experience, do you think?
Well, I think in very simple terms, the staff that crossed from Flinders Street to Spencer Street for the Sunday Age then really went on to sustain the Age for a generation. You know, people like Caroline Wilson, Lawrence Money, Paul Robinson. I mean, the people who kind of built the Sunday Age, and for a while there were looked on, you know, negatively, became the foundation of the Age, and we're still reading their journalism today. So in that sense, it endured for a long time.
Yeah. So Steve, I mean, clearly that massive resources that were, and we saw, you know, and clearly I remember when the Sunday Herald first came out, the sort of the critique across town amongst the journalists was, this is very classy, this has got everything going for it. How do you see from that perspective?
Well, despite perhaps others trying to rewrite the end of the story, our brief very clearly from Murdoch was to produce a top quality newspaper, and he wanted, you know, classy resources pumped into that, and the money really was there to fulfil that. But when I, you know, pause these days and think about the after effects, I think there would have been a fairly cosy, comfortable club in Melbourne until the three Sundays came along. You know, you didn't really regard your competition as serious. Once the poaching wars began and people could see the calibre of the journalists being recruited to these three mastheads, the daily papers, in fact all papers, lifted their game, and I think by extension became much better papers. I think that was the significant turning point from August 20 or thereafter 1989. They got better at what they did, not just in a journalistic sense. I think we saw that in other ways. We saw better promotion of our newspapers across all 7 days. We saw clever, smart radio and TV campaigns built around content, not just generic themes and things like that. So I think we can all proudly look back and say, you know, we forced a massive change, and as a result, journalism became a winner for certainly many years to come.
I think one of the things that, apart from the journalistic aspect of it, I think one of the things the three Sunday papers did is that it finally opened Melbourne on a Sunday. I mean, before the Sunday papers came out, there were no pubs open, there was no football on a Sunday, there was nothing in Melbourne to do. And what we did by dragging the news agents out was to pave the way for Sunday trading. And that was a campaign that I think all the papers embraced. And Melbourne's a very different day on a Sunday now than it was in 1989.
Good. Louise, in terms of photographic and for photographers, was there a positive outcome, do you think, longer term from all of that?
I think there was, in the sense that there was obviously far more opportunity for them. I mean, the Sunday Herald colour magazine was something that we hadn't seen before, and we probably see a bit more of now. It was also a massive opportunity for freelancers, because everyone needed them, and before you just used your staff and that's all you had and that's what you did. But so I think, you know, there was people that made their careers out of being freelancers for the Sundays, and you know, people like Dominic O'Brien, and there was some excellent photographers.
Yeah. In a moment we'll open it up to the room, but I might just ask each of you to say, what was the biggest moment for in that period for your papers? What was your best success?
I think, speaking personally, it was our first Walkley. Paul Robinson, who's here today, we sent Paul off to Thailand. Yep. Because we'd been getting disturbing reports that Australians were in their sex tourism exploits, you know, pedophiles were sort of going to Thailand and picking up young girls. And so Robbo went over there for 2 weeks, investigated the story, did a great job, won a Walkley, and the government changed the law, which is still in force today. And I think that just showed that newspapers can be agents of change. I remember going to the Walkleys. It was just a terrific moment. It was kind of 5 years in, I think, Paul, 4 or 5 years in. And I think it just meant that we'd gotten through all that nonsense and we'd arrived as a newspaper and onward and upward.
Chris?
I can't remember a story. I suppose one of the things we were planning to splash with in our first edition was Bill Hayden's Love Child. But, of course, management decided that that was too news of the world for a nice, staid Melbourne Sunday paper, Sunday tabloid. But we, probably the greatest success we had was with a promotion, and that was our Legends of the Decade medals promotion of the footballers of the decade. And that promotion actually put on 60,000 circulation over a football period of that year, 1990. It was a promotion that we had to re-mint the medals three times and give them away. And the ad that used to appear on the screen at the MCG, where Lee Matthews was hunting around, supposedly in the coach's box, and looking for, basically looking for the medal that he was missing. And he yells out, "Get me, Gary." And that became a slogan that the entire crowd at the MCG shouted every time the ad went up. I think that was our biggest success.
Well, the Sunday Herald was only in existence for about 85 issues, 85 weeks. And it changed a couple of times on the way through. There was two new editors appointed. Alan Farrelly, who launched it, was gone within a year. Never really quite knew what that was about. Then Piers Ackerman came briefly before being elevated to editor-in-chief of the Herald Weekly Times. And in the final months, Alan Howe, who, of course, went on to edit for a very long, distinguished period, the Sunday Herald Sun. So there aren't any particular standout stories. I think we got into a bit of trouble getting hold of the tricontinental documents, and the government, state government injuncted us, so we put a blank space on the front page one Sunday saying, "We can't tell you what this is all about." That sort of story sticks in my mind. But when I think about this, I think I have to say, I look back at the Sunday Herald as a magnificent failure. Not because it was a bad paper or a poor paper. I think it was a very good paper. But I think its problem was it was too good, too far ahead of its time. It needed more time to establish itself. This came through in the wash later on. I discovered we had an advertising agency that launched it, George Patterson's, very famous. But News Limited decided to put the contract out for open tender. So in about March 1990, from memory, they opened it up. George Patterson's were very surprised at that. They'd been a long-standing client, or the Herald had been a long-standing client of theirs. But I did read their submission, and they were, you know, quite open about it. They felt the paper was good, but it needed more time to settle in. Of course, everyone wanted results. There are other competing forces. News Limited was in financial strife. Everyone will know what happened in late 1990 when Rupert had obviously overreached. He had about $7 billion worth of debt. The debt had been parcelled up and sold to myriad banks, and a little tiny bank in Philadelphia was going to foreclose on $10 million, and the whole ship nearly sank. But I think as a consequence of that, he was forced to rationalise and get rid of anything that was losing buckets of money. Of course, we were number one in that stake. So had it had more time, I think it would have probably, you know, done some great stuff.
And of course, it's worth remembering that when the Sunday Herald went under, Fairfax was in receivership. So the industry kind of, if it peaked on August 20, 1989, the kind of dawn didn't last very long, because within 12 months, we were in receivership. Within 15 months, the Herald was gone, the Afternoon Herald, and then the Sunday Herald was gone. So that sort of bright, fuzzy period didn't last long.
Louise, who had the best pictures?
Well, look, I'd have to say the Sunday Age always did.
We always had them.
Wayne Lumbey, we had Wayne Lumbey, and Wayne Lumbey's produced, you know, two extremely iconic images, one of two guys that can't stand each other with their arms around each other, and Winmar, which is probably the most significant picture in AFL history. So I don't think I can go past either of those, frankly. And also the relief of getting that picture that night, I'll never forget.
Yeah. So look, I'd like to... we have a roving mic here. Ordinarily, we kind of stricture no statements, personal recollections, red herrings, meanderings, and people asking questions, but feel free today. Lawrence.
Thank you. I do remember writing a letter on a stationery from the Age which had in receivership under the title of the paper. Should have kept it as a souvenir. One thing hasn't been mentioned, which puzzled me at the time. Given all Murdoch's huge resources and money, the Age was the one that came out in colour. How did that come about, seeing he's the super-duper hero of journalism? Why didn't he wait till he had colour available, and what difference do you think it made to the battle in circulation?
Simply, the presses at Flinders Street couldn't do colour. They would have loved to have done colour, but it was impossible. And it wasn't until he opened the Westgate Park and put new presses there that we had the capacity to do any colour at all.
Yeah, you think he would have waited there, you know?
Yeah, well, I suppose he strike while the iron's hot.
I think Alan Farrelly went on the record saying that colour was not what people wanted from newspapers.
The jury has famously said, the jury is still out on colour.
Yes, and I think it was a very clear advantage for us, even though it did cause production problems. We were doing pages, you know, hours early to accommodate the colour, but I think in the end it was one of the real differences that made us and defined us.
Alan did, ironically, become the guru of colour for the News Limited in one of his subsequent jobs.
The jury came back. Yeah.
Yes, the jury came back and voted for it big time.
Mark?
I ask this from a position of bias, having spent many of my best years working at the Sunday Age, but curious, Bruce, because to me, if that newspaper personified anyone and their approach, it was you, in terms of setting the agenda and the phrase I think you used to me and others was leaving footprints. What footprints in terms of journalism and the way that journalism has been conducted in this state do you think we can actually point back to the Sunday Age and thank them for?
Well, I mean, we didn't invent it, but I think because we were a Sunday paper and we wanted to be a paper that started the week, that didn't end the week. There are papers that end the week and there are papers that start the week. We didn't want to leave that to the Monday Age. We wanted to start the week. And so we were very happy to kind of commit resources to stories. And so we would typically, like, send Paul Robinson to Thailand or say to you, Mark, go away for a couple of weeks and see if you can get the casino documents. I wish journalism was still able to do that. I mean, you have to kind of accept that many times reporters will come back without a story, but that's the cost of investing. And I think that's what we've lost, because every proprietor now wants to stretch every buck as far as they can, and investigative journalism has been put on the back burner. And I think what the Sunday Age proved is that not only could you leave footprints as journalists, but you could bring about change for the good and you could increase circulation. I'd like to think that we had a lasting effect, and I'd like to think that journalism will return to that.
Jim.
Hello, Jim Clark. Philip Knightley was mentioned. Could each of the panel please tell us who did they really chase very vigorously but never actually got? Thank you.
Well, it's been alluded to earlier about the famous poaching wars, which sometimes descended into skullduggery and sometimes descended into French farce. We're all friends, so I think I can tell you a few stories. But we went after people like Mike Sheehan, who's here. We wanted Mike to be our chief football writer, but, you know, he went with the other side. John Stevens, we Dutchessed at a very well-known Melbourne restaurant, Mietta's. I'll never forget that lunch. We were sitting in the grand dining room and Dame Mietta was there, and Farrelly and I were sitting at a table, and in walks none other than Creighton Burns, the editor of The Age, and Mike Smith, his loyal deputy. And I knew Alan didn't know them, and Mike looked at me and, "What are you doing here?" sort of thing. And I realised what was about to happen. Stevens is going to walk into a career-ending trap. But we must have looked distressed, because Mietta came over and said, "Is something wrong?" And we explained what was happening. She said very matter-of-factly, "Follow me." And she took us down to her private dining room on the ground floor, tucked away at the back, and ordered the waiters to bring our food and wine, and there we sat and had a very good lunch. But just before she left, she said, "What do I say if The Age asks, what happened? Where did you go? Why did you leave so hurriedly?" And quick as a flash, Farrelly said, "Tell him Rupert rang." And of course, Rupert did ring.
I think the biggest one that we wanted and couldn't get was Laurie Oakes. We thought we could sway Laurie to come back to his roots. The old Sun is pictorial, but like the news agency, he decided in the end that he needed a day of rest on Sunday with all his television commitments. What you said about Mike Sheehan, Steve, I think all three papers went very hard to try and get Mike. And I know Colin Duck spent a lot of time on our behalf trying to woo him over to the Sunday Sun. And I must say that probably the one scoop that the Sunday Age got, which really hurt us bad, was when Mike got the story about Adelaide coming into the AFL on a Sunday.
Anyone you missed out on, Bruce, you'd like to confess to?
I mean, I don't say this to brag, but we got everyone we wanted.
Right,
okay. No, and I'll tell you the
next
story.
Next, please.
I'll tell you the story.
I agree with that.
Harris was, Steve was studying at Stanford. He was on some dodgy 12-month scholarship or something. Malcolm Schmidtke used to call it the CIA scholarship, but there you go. And so Jan and I flew over to design the paper. We just sketched it out, then gave it to David Clemson, who did all the work. But on day two of that meeting, he said, "So who are we going to hire?" And we came up with 20 names who were working at the Herald, and we got every one of them. So much so that a Herald executive rang me and said, "You're trying to destroy the paper." And I said, in echoes of Roger Ailes, "Mate, we're not recruiting anyone. It's a jailbreak."
Any more questions?
Yeah.
Oh, Kilvington Grammar, our guest.
Yeah. How do you think that if we had the technological resources that we have today, would have improved the Sunday News from 30 years ago?
Of course, when we started, there was no internet. Wasn't conceived, certainly not from a journalistic point of view. There's, I think, a very early version of CNN News, which everyone called chicken noodle news. We didn't think satellite TV would be around for very long. It was mentioned earlier, we didn't have the colour. That was a huge setback for the News Limited Herald and Weekly Times papers, only overcome once they built Westgate Park. But I really wonder, you know, of course you will never know, but what sort of a difference the full panoply of all the stuff we have now would have made had it been around at the time. And when Lawrence says maybe it would have been smart to hold off, perhaps, we really were doing it not quite on typewriters with, you know, faded ribbons, but not much more beyond that. And I think with the benefit of hindsight, another 10 years might have been a different story.
If it had the internet, you could have stolen all your content. You would have been fine. Chris, did you
want to... contributors. Certainly all the contributors.
Okay. One more. Sue.
You mentioned journalism nirvana. What aspects
of nirvana were there that are not in our work life now?
Well, perhaps in an echo of the internet, as your previous questioner asked, to some extent the Sundays were like, certainly the Sunday Age, without that sort of rigid hand of Rupert sort of hanging over us, we were kind of left to do whatever we wanted. It was like a journalistic laboratory in that sense. And we would try things on a Sunday, and if it didn't get any traction, it wouldn't come back. And we did like things like we had the Sunday Age jury, where we recruited 12 people. And the idea is we would go to them every week and say, well, what do you think of this? That lasted 2 weeks. We got bored with it. We changed the masthead between issues 4 and 5. Steve and I were sitting on the back bench and I said, I think our masthead is really underdone. And he said, well, let's change it. And so we changed it. And it was so liberating to kind of be allowed to do that in a way that I guess would never happen today.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. I mean, those days were different in the sense that as the editor, you could change the paper without having to refer to management and worry about how many pages you're going to put on and fight with the advertising department, kick their ads around and throw them out the paper. Those days are gone. It's much too rigid now.
Another question here. Jeff.
Well, it's not a question more than as much as a statement. As Mickey Sheehan's clearly not going to make it himself. He, of course, had been not only chased but secured years before all this by the short-lived Newsday. And Michael and I, he was plucked from the Werribee banner to go and work at Newsday, and Newsday is celebrating its 50th anniversary. 30, okay.
maybe next Friday. Yeah.
We're celebrating our 50th anniversary at a venue yet to be announced on the 1st of October, which is a couple of days after the grand final, so we can all sober up before we get stuck into it again. So is anybody in the room who worked at Newsday, is related to anybody who worked at Newsday? Please let Michael or myself know. Bought a copy of Newsday, that's right. somebody mentioned the baby on the front page, Newsday's baby, Julie Zuzunas. We've tracked her down and she's going to be front and centre at the party. She's looking forward to it. So there you go. That is, somebody mentioned warm and fuzzy periods that didn't last very long, and that was another one of them. Thank you.
Jeff, of course, Newsday was intended to be a Sunday paper, wasn't it? They had ambitions at Spencer Street of making it a Sunday in about, 1969, I guess.
I have to take your word for that, Stephen, because
no,
true. I was in the mail room at the Herald Weekly Times when I was plucked.
They couldn't get the agents to open, and I think there's fairly extortionate rates from the printers for working on a Saturday night. So they switched it ill-fatedly to an afternoon paper.
All right, we've heard all these wonderful successes and what have you, but what was the worst moment, the most terrible cock-up, the worst mistake, loss, missed yarn, etc.? Bruce?
Well, it involved a tram conductor. Tony Parkinson did a week-long exposé of Melbourne's public transport system, and again, Lutters, on a Friday night, delivered this fantastic page one picture showing a tram conductor having a VB in between shifts before he got back on the tram. He was on the tram. It was an Abbott's. Thanks, Jeffrey. Yes, you're right. It was an Abbott's. And anyway, we knew we had this great page one picture. And actually, I'll bring my wife into the story, because that morning, at the Saturday morning at the kitchen table, I mentioned the picture and she said, why don't you put the headline on it, if you drink and drive, you're a bloody tram conductor. Which we did. Anyway, long story short, he swore black and blue that he was actually drinking ginger beer. So much so that tram drivers massed outside the Age building Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday and Friday of the next week. And on the Saturday night, thousands of them blocked the paper from coming out until Steve and I met with Lou Di Gregorio, who said, we've got to make this go away. So we apologised for the headline. But we didn't deny the story. But of course, Lou Di Gregorio being walked straight out of the building to the waiting press and said, what's happened? He said, they've apologised, they've admitted they were wrong, you can all go home. And we got the paper out at 3 a.m.
Chris?
I think the story that I probably copped the most flack over, because I didn't think it was a story that really was newsworthy for to be the splash in Melbourne, was when Laurie Connell was done for, I don't know what it was, insider trading or whatever it was, in West Australia and arrested. And both The Age and The Herald led their paper with it. And I made it a little small story on page 2. I'm still trying to work out why I got so much flack, but obviously the powers that be, who were very Sydney-oriented in those days, were really into that sort of story.
Well, Mark's already mentioned this, but I'll never forget it. Alan Farrelly used to say to me, you're not an editor until you've stood next to the lightning. I didn't know what he meant until he took his first leave just after our launch and left me in charge to run the place for a month. And we'd sent Mark and Rob Leeson, who's down the back, to Bougainville on this story that Mark wanted to cover, essentially about rebels driving white settlers out of their plantations. And on the Thursday morning, I took a call from a guy named Jim Dollymore of Foreign Affairs, some of you might remember, and he's always spoken a very grave voice. And he said, there's been an incident with a helicopter. Well, my stomach just hit the floor. I felt sick. I thought it had crashed. As it turns out, as Mark has told you, he was shot and then evacuated. It didn't have happy consequences, and I've said to Mark recently, it wasn't our finest hour, the way it all ended, and I don't need to remind Mark of that outcome, but on the Friday, I got a lot of pressure from the News Limited Saturdays, who wanted Mark's story, and this was the best story, despite what had happened, we'd had in a couple of months, and I refused to give it. I came under a lot of flack from, you know, certain heavies in News Limited, but I stood my ground and we ran it, you know, gloriously across the front page and inside on the Sunday. But I think my editing card was marked from that day on.
Sorry about that, Stu. Louise.
Oh, look, I actually don't have anything that I regret or miss. The only thing I do regret, perhaps, is a more personal thing, that I went to the Sunday Herald colour magazine. Because about 3 or 4 months after I got there, Piers Ackerman turned up and cut the budget in half and my wage in half. So I thought, what am I doing here? Why didn't I stay at the Sunday Age? So that was really more my missed opportunity.
I was just going to say that the story we splashed on, instead of Laurie Connell, was that Starsky had been done for drugs at Starsky and Hutch.
Much better story. Much better story, Chris.
All right. I think we're exhausted. All right. Well, look, thank you very much. You've put you through your paces up here. Thank you to our panel and thank you, everyone, for being here. You're welcome to linger, mingle for a while, and the bar remains open if you wish to order additional drinks. But thank you all for coming, and see you at another Melbourne Press Club event, I hope. Okay. Cheers.